Hello, lovelies. Welcome to the February 2024 episode of the Not Quite Enough Yarn podcast. My name's Leslie, and this is a podcast about yarn, knitting, crochet, spinning, all the lovely fibery stuff, recorded on the south coast of the UK. Welcome, whether you're here for the first time or you're returning, it's lovely to have you here, so thank you so much. I normally record throughout the month and then put the pieces together and post on the last weekend of each month. I also do a weekly vlog, which is a little bit about crafting, normally telling you what I've finished, but more about life. And that goes up every Friday evening, UK time. So whatever that is, wherever you are. Thanks for all the comments, the likes, subscribe, the support I've received in the last month. I really do appreciate it. Thank you. It means a lot, so thank you very much. It's called the Not Quite Enough Yarn podcast because although I have plenty, I rarely have more than one or two balls or skeins in the same colour. So I put a lot of things together in different colour ways. Comme ça. So it's not quite enough, although there is plenty. Hope everyone's well. Hope everyone is enjoying whatever weather you're having. We have a lovely sunny day here, although it's cold. But it's not raining, which it has been a lot recently, and it's not snowing, which it could be. So I, for one, am grateful for a bright sunny day. We've got a make-along going along. Gosh, my sentences are very poor today, aren't they? Hopefully they'll get better as the month progresses. But we have a make-along happening, and that is the Modification MAL. It's happening on Ravelry. There is a thread on the Not Quite Enough Yarn podcast group. So please do post your thoughts, your comments, your pictures, all of that good stuff on there. If you're unable to use Ravelry, please email me your entries on using notquiteenoughyarn@gmail.com. And I will post them onto the thread for you. So what constitutes a modification? It's interesting, I was watching Ellie from Skein Deer Knits, and she was talking about modifying patterns, and she was saying, you know, it's something that all knitters do. I would refute that slightly, but it is something that I think a lot of knitters do. And I'm encouraging you to do that. So what I'm going to start off with, what doesn't constitute a modification. If it's a straight yarn substitution, so you're using a different yarn to the one specified in the pattern, but you're getting the same gauge. So that might be that you're swapping one double knitting weight yarn for another, or you're doubling up some four ply weight to get a worsted or Aran equivalent, but you're still getting the same gauge. That's yarn substitution. You're not actually changing anything in the pattern. With the modification MAL, what I'm looking for is when you've actually changed something. So that might be taking a knitting pattern, for example, like the Boxy by Hohe Locatelli, and turning it into a crochet pattern. You don't have to be that extreme. It might be taking a pattern for a short-sleeved top and turning it into a long-sleeved cardigan. More on this later. Again, you don't have to be that extreme. It can be as simple as changing the length of the sweater that you're making, adding some waist shaping, putting a different heel into the type of sock that you're making, changing sleeve length, any of those things, anything that you've had to change what was originally written in the pattern, whether that be because you're using a different weight of yarn, so you're getting a different gauge and you've had to recalculate some things, or because you've changed something in the schematic, if you will. So like I say, shaping, it might be putting an A-line into a straight sweater, for example. So where you've had to change something in the pattern, that's a modification. So basically, if you're the sort of pattern that, if you're the sort of crafter that works from paper patterns, if you've had to write something on it because you've altered it, that counts as a modification. Prizes are being drawn quarterly. This whole thing runs till the end of September, and I'm going to draw prizes every quarter. So from the thread on Ravelry, the first number I draw that has a picture attached will be physical prize, probably a yarn prize, because I'm going to unravel at the end of this month, so I shall buy something gorgeous there. And if it's a post without a picture attached, it'll be a pattern prize up to the value of, I think I said $15 US. All the details are in the notes below. They're also on the thread on Ravelry. But if you have any questions, please do shout. WIPs are allowed if they were started on or after the 24th of December last year. It was going to be a this year only contest, but a lot of people had Christmas Eve cast-ons and New Year's Eve cast-ons and that sort of thing. And in the spirit of the Modification MAL, I modified the rules a bit to allow for those projects. So I think that's everything. And of course, if you design your own patterns, that's the ultimate modification, so that's certainly allowed. So huge thank you to everyone who's taken part. This has been embraced much more enthusiastically than I was expecting. Just everyone seems to be really up for it, so thank you. And like I say, these aren't big modifications necessarily. It might be a different type of ribbing or a different type of neckband, or the pattern says an afterthought heel, but you've put in a slip stitch and gusset. Heel flap and gusset even. Well, they have slip stitches usually. Yeah. Yeah, just whatever requires a bit of rethinking, recalculating and reworking. Thank you for being part of it. And it's a very inspiring thread to go through and look at what people are making. As always, my queue is growing and growing and growing. So I have a finished object. That's the MAL. And this was modified, as I hinted a moment ago. So what we've got here is a Magpie Tendency, which is a pattern by Skinanigans for a short-sleeved top. And the original pattern uses two skeins of 4-ply or fingering weight yarn, so about 800 metres of yarn, on a large gauge, so it's something like a 5mm needle, so a much larger gauge than you would normally use with that weight of yarn. And it's a quick, fun top. I have made three. The first one I made according to the pattern, which is unusual for me. The second one I modified with stitch pattern, the third one I modified a sleeve length, I think. I'll put pictures here, you can choose your modification pattern choices. But I had a feeling that I would quite like a magpie cardigan. I'm a keen cardigan wearer. I'm a keen sweater wearer. But I do like a cardi. I'm of an age where I get warm and like to take my layers off. Excuse my phone pinging. So I thought I would make a magpie cardigan. And it required a bit of reworking, but not too bad. Essentially, the front piece, you're splitting the numbers in half. You may want to add one or two stitches on for edging, but essentially you're just working the front in two halves. And because of the way this is constructed, I just had to change slightly where the centre back was. No, that's not quite right. I don't think I'm giving too much away. It's a paid for pattern, but I don't think I'm giving too much away to say that it's an I-cord start. So you make a loop of I-cord, then you have two saddle shoulders effectively, and then the fronts and backs, front and back, are knitted down from there. I had to make sure that the end of my I-cord was centre front, so there was a bit of recalculation as to where I picked up stitches for the components of the sweater. So that was it. It's a very oversized sweater, which is my favourite type. And I've realised I don't usually tell you the sizes that I'm making. So I'll tell you how much yarn I used, but not what size I produce, which is probably not helpful. This is massively oversized in terms of width. So pit to pit, 36 inches. So we are talking boxy bagginess here, which is just how I like them. It's quite short, because I didn't have quite enough yarn to make it longer. If I were making another, and I probably will, I would make it longer as well. But I think this will probably drop with wash and wear. When I go through the yarn, you'll understand why. It's a predominantly acrylic mix, and from experience they tend to drop with use. So what is the yarn? It is Nako, say that carefully, Mohair Special Romantic Jacquard. Himself got me two balls of this on one of his travels. Don't ask me where. He's had many travels. He brings me back yarn. He's a nice guy. I like him. I'll keep him for now. Very pretty colours. And you can see one was sort of dark green and the other has some of those greens, but with reds and browns as well. So I knew that they would go well together because they had, in Venn diagram terms, they had an overlapping colour in the green. The yarn is listed as a double knitting weight, but it feels much finer than that, which is why I was happy to use it for this pattern. And it reminds me very much of Shh, which is either by King Cole or James C. Brett. I can't remember which. I'll put it on the screen. I have a couple of balls of that as well. Good old himself. It's a sort of soft, fluffy yarn. According to the band and according to online, it's DK weight, but it feels much finer. So the makeup is 10% mohair, 10% wool, 3% metallic, because this is very sparkly, and 77% premium acrylic, which is why I think it will probably drop as I wash it and wear it. There are 540 metres in each ball. And I used all but this in the two balls, so I'm counting that as 1,000 meters. There you go. Bit of yarn management required when I was working the fronts down. I wanted to make sure that they matched, so I sort of moved the yarn along a little to the next similar colourway so that they would pretty much match at the fronts. Didn't have to worry so much about the second colour because by this point I had knitted down to where I joined after the arms, and so that was all one colour. Bit of slightly less successful yarn management on the sleeves, but close enough. And I'm very pleased with it. I was wearing it yesterday for a little while. It's warmer than it looks, given that it's short and airy. It is warmer than it looks, and I think the mohair in that helps. Sleeves are made sort of bracelet length, just picked up the stitches as per the pattern, but then decreased and worked longer. So that's that. Those are all my modifications. Oh, apart from the edging. So I did an I-cord bind off at the bottom. I started to do an I-cord all the way around and I was getting myself in a pickle. For some reason on this edge, it just felt as if it was all baggy and nasty and not playing nicely. So I decided to just pick up the stitches and do a garter stitch. And actually feeling that actually feels a little bit pulled tight. So I may do something about that. But that was just, and it was just a garter stitch, three or four rows, and it kind of sits flat because it's garter stitch. After I'd done the I-cord binding at the bottom, I just carried on up the side and it worked fine. And then for a button loop, you can see that. So I just was doing the attached I-cord, did a few rows of an I-cord, then the next row was reattached back in the same place and carried on to the end and grafted it to the I-cord at the top. So that was that. So there's my button loop. And the button was just an old one I had in stash. I have a lot of buttons that I've inherited from various relatives, stash, friends, relatives, and yeah. So a finished object, which has taken far longer than I feel it needed to. I started it in September, but then kind of got waylaid with other projects and Christmas and my Advent sweater and all of that sort of thing. So that was as far as I'd got. And then I didn't really, couldn't get a lot of enthusiasm to go back to it. I was finding it a bit monotonous, which is odd because I do like the magpie and it is a quick knit because you are working such good sized needles for the thickness of the yarn. So I don't know why I was just not in the mood for it, but I was away for a few days, took it with me. It was the only project I took. That worked a treat. So I managed to plough on. And of course, once you get within sight of the finishing line, then the enthusiasm returns because you're kind of almost there. So that is that, I think. Now, I can enter this and have already entered it into a couple of make-alongs. Not my own. I mean, I could enter it into the Modification MAL, but I think entering my own make-along would be a bit daft and somewhat suspicious if I won the prize. But there are two make-alongs going on that I can enter it into. So the first is Anne of Sparknits. Anne's other name is Sparknits, of the No Excuses podcast. And she has a jumper-along make-along, which is for any adult size jumper, cardigan, anything that's designed to be outerwear. So you could do a sleeveless top, but not one that's designed to go under your clothes, next to skin. It's designed to be outerwear. So that works for that. So that's in there. And also Karen of Recreational Knitting has a Whip Begone and a Stash Begone make along. Now, as I'd already started this last year, not eligible for the Stash Begone, although anything I make out of these babies would be, but is eligible for the Whip Begone because it was started last year and it's now finished. So I will link, well, all the podcasts I've watched regularly are linked below. So that's Recreational Knitting for the Whip Begone and No Excuses podcast for the jumper along. So check them out. I'm sure you already watched them anyway, but if you don't, highly recommend. And nice to enter them into the make-along. Take part in something more than just my own knitting. So that's lovely. I think that's it for that project. But I'm glad I've got an FO. Cheers. Hello, lovelies. This little section is called Acquisitions and a Fail. I'll do the acquisitions first. Himself went to Portugal and came back with some yarn. And COVID, as it turned out. Himself is currently staying in the spare room and I'm staying in this office most of the time. Oh, what fun. He's got cold symptoms. I mean, it's not dire. It's unfortunate timing, but it could be a lot worse. He just feels like he's got a bad cold. So I am perhaps not as sympathetic as I would otherwise be. There's a lot going on. But he very kindly, before he got COVID, brought me back some yarn, which I will go through with you. So the brand is All Rosarioche 4. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. Let me show you the... And as you can see, this first one is the Cagnamo, I think, tweed, which looks as if it would be quite a rustic feeling yarn, but it is beautifully soft. It is 71% merino, 10% alpaca, 10% hemp, which is Cagnamo, and 9% viscose. 130 meters per 50 grams. Colorway is a number, it's number 15. And that's a very nice tweed, very nice feel to it. So the next one he bought was also colour number 15. Oh, there's my phone. Real Merino. Now, this is listed as a DK weight, but it feels finer than that. And I will come on to that with the fail. So it's 100% superwash wool, but given that it's called Real Merino, I'm assuming it's Merino. It's 290 metres per 100 grams, and to me, that feels like more of a sport weight, and the thickness of it looks like more of a sport weight as well. So, very nice feel to it, as you would imagine. This next one is a little more rustic and very pretty. Pio Pardo. I wish I spoke any Portuguese apart from thank you. Obrigado. So this is colour number 3, and this is 100% wool. And it definitely has a kind of handspun feel to it. You can see barber poling there. So, very nice. Although it's more rustic, it's not rustic. I mean, it's... Yeah, I don't know if I'd put it close to neck, but it would certainly be fine for kind of sweaters and that kind of thing. But these two are very soft. So these are the type that are kind of... They're chain construction, and I'm thinking this is pronounced Olyapim. So we've got colour number 4 and colour number 13, and these are lovely. So 120 meters per 50 gram recommended needle size, 5 to 6 millimeters, or 8 to 10 USA, so that little bit thicker. And it's 85% wool, extra fine merino, 15% polyamide. Very soft and squishy. So we say thank you again to himself, who has very good choice in colours and yarns. Our young Jedi have trained him well. You'll understand why I'm talking about this now, with my fail. I had in my queue the table of shame of the whips that I wanted and the queue I wanted and so forth. The Ebby Carden by, I think it's Alice Satano. It's a Brooklyn tweed pattern and it's a very nice ripply cardigan. It's quite a thick wadge of paper for the pattern. This is partly because it's available across a very broad size range, which I always like to see. But the construction is such that, personally, I think I would have written it in a slightly different way. And it would help immensely to have a schematic showing how the sections go together, because it's a knitted sideways, so it's not your normal construction. And so I would have written things in a slightly different order. But designer's prerogative. Very nice pattern, absolutely fine. But as a result, and I'm doing this in a number of different yarns of all different colours, they're all double knitting weight merino, but I'm doing a sort of, I shouldn't really call it a gradient because it's not a natural gradient from one colour to the next, but I'm kind of making them fit together as nicely as I can with the yarn that I've got. So the first section I made was in Rooster, in this lovely turquoise tealy colour. And then I had to make another section, and based on where that was going, I wanted to use a lighter colour than I had for the teal. Now, I could have used a darker one. I can use what I like, it's my knitting. And actually, this wouldn't have been a bad choice as a colour, but I thought I would go with something lighter, and this is some Cascade 220, and I think it's the mint colourway. But this is worsted weight, and this is DK, and I didn't think it would make that much of a difference, but when you compare two patterns with the same stitch count, she's not massively different. But the density of this fabric is very different indeed. And most of the yarn that I've got is this, or this weight. So I have decided, I went through a sort of thought process of what do I do? And basically I've decided to frog it. Too long didn't read version, decided to frog it. I'm going to make this sweater, but I have in my stash a big, I bought this huge hank of, I think it's an acrylic yarn, purples with the odd bit of bright pink in it. That's what I'm going to use for this Ebby cardigan. I think it will just be easier from my point of view if I'm doing it all in one yarn. Like I say, could have used this because it's the right type of yarn, the merino, but because it feels a lot finer and because I'm getting an awful lot more meters per 50 grams or 100 grams, I just thought this is going to be the same problem but in the other direction. I'll knit the piece and it will be a lot looser and a lot smaller than my original. So I am frogging this. My biggest mistake is getting all of this knitted before I realised just how much I didn't like it. It's, just not... I like this yarn, I like this pattern, I just don't like the two together. And they're not designed to be together, so that makes sense. You know, it's not... It's one of those things. So what am I going to make instead? Well, I am going to make a completely different style of sweater. Like I say, I will make the Ebby. It's going into the naughty corner at the moment because I've already spent a fair amount of time making bits. And if I were to just pick up the other yarn and start that, I don't think I would be feeling the love for it. I think it needs a little rest or it needs me to get away from that pattern just for a little while. Just chillax. And... thank you very much, good night for the moment. So what I'm going to make is the top down half zip pullover by Sue McCain, and I've got it in black and white, but I will put a pattern picture on screen as well, and we'll see how we go from there. So this is top down, as it suggests. It's a raglan sleeve. I am probably not going to do the stitch pattern. It has a seeded rib pattern, which I'm probably not going to do. Now, it is a very size inclusive pattern. It goes up to an 8XL, which means the finished measurement, the largest chest size, is 73¼ inches. So that's a very good size range. Smallest is 33½, so it's not as if it only deals with larger sizes. It goes across a big range. And as it's a simpler construction, because it's worked top down, the Ebby's worked sideways, you know, there's lots of different bits to it, but this is much simpler. That has, you know, that many pages of instructions. This has three. I think because of the way I'm mixing colours on this, that will be a better choice. So that's the thought process. So now comes the bit where we start unpicking. Yes, it's always sad to start frogging. But, like I say, my biggest mistake is actually doing this many rows before I thought, do you know what, this isn't working. And I think that was that kind of triumph of hope over expectation thing that you think, I'll give it a few more rows, see how it's going. And sometimes you just know that it's not right, but you keep going anyway because you don't want to frog it. And you just end up frogging more. Yay. But hey, that's okay. It's fine. We are adults. We can unpick our knitting. It's all right. It's only yarn. Very nice yarn. Very pretty yarn. But it's only yarn. And the beauty of yarn is that it can be reused. So we're going to reuse this. Not in the same project. But this will be reused in something else. So disappointing to have a fail, as always, but better to have a fail in the very early stages than in the very late stages. The only other thing I would say about the top down half zip, although I like the seed stitch pattern that it has on it, I'm actually going to do it in plain stocking stitch, and I am knitting a smaller size than I would normally do accordingly. So it gives you the gauge for the stitch pattern that it has, On Ravelry there's a gauge for plain stocking stitch, so that's what I'm working on. I'm making an oversized sweater because I like oversized sweaters, always. But it's not going to be as oversized. I always like it, what's that phrase I use? Big enough to float, not so big that I drown. So that's what my aim is here. So I'll catch up with you later in the month. Cheers. Hello lovelies. This section we will call an alteration, a finished spin, and an unopening. I don't normally give my sections titles, I'm not sure why I did that. But alteration first of all. Now this was the crochet boxy that I made latter part of last year and ran out of yarn, kill surprise, so made cap sleeves, sort of short sleeves on it. And I haven't worn it since, and I think it's because I put short sleeves on it. And I prefer something a little longer on the sleeve. Now I've possibly not put quite enough, not quite enough sleeves, there we go. But took some of the plain brown yarn, which I used at the base of this. And I had about 5 or 6 rows of the colour, unpicked it, left just a couple of rows, and then staggered the coloured rows in. Not blocked, as you can see, because it's all a little bit lumpy bumpy. But I think that will make it a more wearable item for me. So there we go. Alteration done. It's something I've been putting off, and it was an evening's work. I mean, just, you know. However, finished spin. So I've got some spinning loveliness here to say, to show you. And I am not a, excuse my phone. I'm not a massively experienced spinner. I spin a lot, but I spin the same type of thing. I'm not very consistent. I love doing it, which is why I do it so much. But this is pretty good. This is fairly consistent. If I hold it up to the camera. So you can see here, I've got fairly even thickness all the way down. This fibre, I love these colours, turquoise and purple together. It's probably my favourite two colour pairing. It's just lovely, lovely. It drafted really nicely. Love the colours. Really happy with how the yarn came out. Just wish I knew what the fibre was. So it was in my box of fibre without a label, and I've no idea what it is. There's 91 grams of it, but that's as much as I know. Drafting it, it felt a bit like the Polworth that I drafted a few skeins ago, but I could be way off on that. But yeah, it certainly drafted really nicely and everything sort of came apart fairly evenly. I've done a classic 3-ply, which is my kind of go-to, I think. 153 metres. 12 wraps per inch. I'm very happy with how it's come out. It's not absolutely consistent. I can show you some thicker bits, but I am pleased. I think because I'd put a fair bit of time into the drafting, that kind of came good in the spinning. So what I've done is I've put all of my hand spun into a single container. I had it in my jars and in amongst the stash. And I've put it into a single container, so I will add this to it. And that's been quite useful because it's enabled me to kind of see what I've got in handspun. I fancy making something purely out of handspun, but because I've kind of consolidated it, put it all together, know what I've got, I can now make a plan for what I will spin next. I've got a bat on the wheel at the moment, but the next colours I spin, for example, will be perhaps to go with handspun that I've already got to build up a quantity for whatever I want to make. So trying to be a little bit more thoughtful and mindful. That's the theory. I'm good at those theories. So yes, got this, which is marvellous. And let's have an unwrapping, because Jude had his last shop update. Jude of Stranded Dye Works is putting the business onto what he's calling a temporary hiatus. And he had his last shop update. And I wasn't going to buy anything because I don't need to buy anything and I'm going to a yarn festival. But I happened to be just finishing on my computer about 7:02 on the day of the shop update. And I couldn't stop myself. Could not resist. Didn't want to resist. Why should I resist? It's one of those mad dash things. It was like buying Glastonbury tickets. It was just insane. He had over 400 skeins. I think it sold out in about 20 minutes or something equally ridiculous. I put three things into my cart. Afterwards, I was thinking, oh, I wish I'd looked for this colour or that colour or this one. But the last one I put in had sold out by the time I checked out. So had I spent any more time looking, I think I wouldn't have got what I got. So let's open her up. Oh, oh goodness me. So we have got, excuse the rattly plastic, crayon in superwash merino nylon. Fingering weight. Let's take it out of there. Look at this beautiful yarn. So pretty. Oh goodness. So then I also ordered one of the grab bags. These are bags of mixed bags of different weights, different bases, and they are colours no longer being done or colours that didn't quite meet his spec or just stuff he was trying out. But oh my goodness, what did I say about liking purple and turquoise together? So we have merino yak nylon fingering, 70% superwash merino, 20% yak, 10% nylon. This is a one-of-a-kind colourway. Now on my camera screen it's showing up a slightly bluer green than it is. It's less blue than it's showing. It's just a really lovely dark green. Oh, so pretty. We have Merino DK, again in a one-of-a-kind. And this is slightly tonal. So this could possibly go in the ebby that I unpicked when I'm making the top down zipper. It's possible, it's possible. And then this, which is a paint box one of a kind, it's 75% merino, 25% nylon, but this looks very close to a version of Stranded Elf, which I have in the DK, but I am delighted to have it in these colours, in this weight rather. Oh my goodness, what beautiful yarn. So on a yarn buying point of view, obviously I'm very sad that Jude is no longer dyeing in yarn. From a make point of view, I'm delighted that he's finding new things to do, new excitement to find, new adventures to follow. So I shouldn't have bought any of these, but I'm very glad I did. Hello lovelies. Taking a leaf out of Karen from Recreational Knitting's book, where she's having a February finish or frog, I'm gonna frog. I started making, and I've got a little way, but I had started making some gloves. These are gloves for when I take burial ceremonies. And the idea is that they have individual fingers, but the first finger and the thumb have a bit left off the top, so you can turn pages. I called them initially commuter gloves, so you could like be on your phone and what have you. And I started these, I don't know how long ago, and I'm just not enjoying it. I have been putting these off for so long that my yarn's getting in a tangle. And this yarn, which is Merlin from Black Elephant, in the Gloaming colourway, it's just too beautiful to be sitting in a project bag not used. Now that's not making an insult to any of the other yarn that I've got sitting in that cupboard not used, because there's a fair bit. But I haven't used this. Now I don't know if part of it is, this is a single ply, I think. It's certainly very soft. The yarn is 90% superwash merino, 10% linen. No, it may be plied, but it's quite a loose ply if it is. I don't know how hard wearing it would be with gloves. Obviously, making gloves isn't like making socks. You haven't got that same amount of pressure and wear. But it's just not working for me. Now, I'm making these from my own pattern, so you can draw your own conclusion as to what I think about the quality of that. Actually, it's okay. It was a published pattern. It's fine. But it's just not working for me at the moment. This may be to do with the fact that I have made 4 pairs of mittens in the last few months. You know, maybe I'm just not feeling the glove love at the moment. And this yarn really is in a tangle. And if I want a pair of gloves with the fingertips cut off, I'll get a pair of fleece gloves and cut the fingertips off. Or I'll make some. You know, I can make some. I have the pattern here. I have the yarn. I'm just not going to make them in this yarn with these needles out of this pattern right now. So this is about to be frogged. If I could work out which end of the yarn I was using, that would be handy. We do seem to be in a right old tangle. Oh, hello, there's an end. Right, what does that belong to? Oh, right. So I was pulling from the centre. Good to know. Right, so more frogging. But if you start frogging something and it feels like a bit of a weight has been lifted, then that's probably a good sign that you needed to frog it. And it means this lovely yarn, I think, might go into a wrap of some description. Fancy a long wrap. And I think this would be a good addition to that. That's why this month's episode is called the Frog Chorus. Bum, bum, bum. Bum, bum, bum. Bum, 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 bum. Cheers. Hello, lovelies. How are we? Hope everyone's okay. Time for a bit of life update and a kind of roundup of WIPs. And I'm going to do them in that order because the life update may explain some of the WIPs. Those of you who watch the blog will already know this, but my father died at the end of January. He needed some surgery. It then became emergency surgery as events overtook, and came through the surgery okay, but didn't come through the recovery. So that is horrible, and my heart goes out to all who are affected by grief. And a big thank you to everyone who has commented on the weekly vlogs and that sort of thing. And also given me space when I needed it, because I did for a little while. So thank you to everyone for your support. It is very, very much appreciated. So with that happening, I go into a bit of a mindset thing where I want to clear everything up, tidy everything up, and when it comes to crafting, I want comfort crafting. Okay. So the first thing I did was to put together all the little balls of yarn I had. I had been given, about this time last year, I'd been given a sort of carry bag full of bits of yarn. And some of them, a lot of them, I could use for hats for homeless people because I could use them in the whirly whirly machine. They're sort of double knitting weight, goes nicely through that. But some were Aran. And Aran is just a little bit too thick. Worsted fine, Aran a little bit too thick. So I had all these little balls of Aran, and there were, I'm assuming they'd been used for projects and they were kind of the end balls. So these would have been projects made in pieces and these were all the little bits left over. So I had a lot of balls of the same colour, but that kind of size. So I decided, I'd been sort of trying to think for a while what to do. And it occurred to me that a granny square is one of the most forgiving things you can make. Because you can use yarns of slightly different weights, you know, it doesn't matter if things are a bit different. It's very forgiving, it will just keep going in the right direction. So I put all these bits together, and I'm calling this the scrap ball as big as my head granny square. I have tried to put some kind of logic to the yarn colours, so they should go in a kind of natural flow, and where I've had lots of balls of, you know, that sort of size, I've put them together. This is where we are so far. It'd be a rectangular granny. So I'm calling it a granny square, but it's a granny rectangle. And it will just be as big as it gets. Depending on how big it gets, how useful it appears, it may go to charity, it may go to donation, it may go to a friend or family member who wants it. I haven't decided yet. But it's just something that I can work on without thinking. The first thing I ever crocheted was a granny square, and that was 50 odd years ago, so I don't have to think about them. Doesn't mean to say I don't sometimes make mistakes. Sometimes my corners only have one block of three trebles instead of two, but again, it's forgiving. It allows you to get around that, so literally. So this is one of my whips. Now this is going to be a pick up and put down when I think about it kind of whip. I don't know when I'll ever finish it. It's easy enough to work on without thinking. But not the most portable of projects, given that I do have a ball of yarn the size of my head. So we shall see on this one, but it's the first of the whips that I'm showing you. So I need to put a stitch marker on there at some point to show you where I am when I next show you it. That was an appalling sentence. Hopefully you have some idea what I mean, because I'm not sure I do. Right, next project. So I told you about the Ebby that I started, and it just wasn't working for me because I was doing it in more than one colour, and the way it was written, the colours weren't going to work out the way I wanted, and I was kind of losing patience by that point. Oh, excuse all the banging noise, sorry. So I have started the top-down collared half-zip, which I probably won't put a zip in, sweater. And that's as far as I've got. So this is Rooster Almerino DK in the beach colourway. And that's where I am with that one. It's quite a tight tension. I did a gauge swatch. I know, who'd have thought it? And it's quite a dense fabric. But that will make it nice, and it's all merino, so it'll be lovely and soft. Yes, it will probably peel like nobody's business, but that's okay. So I have all my yarns in this little box, or this big box, including my newest one from Stranded, which I may or may not use. So that is The next whip. The next one is a redesign of one of my own patterns. So this is back from 20,000 Frozen to Death. I'll put the date on screen. I used to design for the odd magazine. Well, the magazines weren't that odd, but some of the designs were. And the nature of the magazines and my attitude towards designing at that point was I would just say to them, what size range do you want? And sometimes I might push it up one or two sizes, but nothing too kind of radical. And so I designed a number of patterns that I couldn't make for myself. Some of them, I'll be honest, I wouldn't want to. Not my style, just something that fitted their aesthetic, fine. But I thought I would have a go. So I'll show you this, but I'll also show you a picture of it because it looks rather different once it's finished. So it's a cable and garter pattern. But on the side of each cable, you have a stitch that you drop when you come to the end. So it opens it all up, as this picture will show. I am using a selection of cotton from the stash. So this is some stuff that I bought in Madeira some years ago. This was some inherited stash. I've got all sorts of things in here. Basically, if it's cotton or at least 50% cotton, it's an option for this sweater. Again, it's not going to be the world's quickest knit. I mean, it's not as slow as it could be because of those drop stitches. So once you do that, of course, the whole thing expands. So you're making a smaller piece than you would think. It's made in two pieces, I think. Maybe be in one, I'm not sure. But basically, you knit up, increase for the sleeves, so that the cable pattern on the sleeves goes in the same direction as it does on the sweater. And then you drop the stitches just before you cast off. So again, it's not necessarily going to be a super quick knit. It would make sense to keep working on it fairly steadily because it's a useful kind of summer throwover type of thing, especially being in cotton. But not a race. We'll see how the mood takes me. There may be other things that I want to work on, but I would like to kind of make it, possibly make it available in a more size inclusive range. So that means I'll get it tech edited and so forth, but we'll see about that. I mean, it depends. I don't know what interest would be, and it might not be what anyone would want. So that's that one. My last one, I haven't started yet, but I'm about to cast on this evening. And this really is a, you've had a rough time lately, haven't you, Les, cast on. Got it into my head. Sentences that chill the blood. That I wanted, I've got some yarn here that I wanted to make a fluffy jacket or coat. I don't know why. I'm going to look ridiculous. I will look like a teddy bear. A very cute teddy bear, but a teddy bear all the same. Do not be surprised if at any point in the future this project has been unpicked and I've had a quick word with myself and decided to be a bit more sensible, because it is ridiculous. But what I'm really feeling the need for at the moment is a quick make with minimal preparation and just pick up and knit. And when you want something like that, and it's not a granny square, if you want a garment where you can just pick up and knit, no preparation required, then you need Nicola Suzanne. Last year I made a cardigan from her Eureka pattern, which I will put a picture in here. And the beauty of some of her patterns is that they don't require a gauge swatch. You just start knitting. You have some measurements that you're working towards, but you just start knitting. And that is exactly what I'm after at the moment. So here is the Eureka pattern. So I've put the date on it, 22nd of February 2024. This is today, this is when I'm starting it. And It's a sort of A-line cardigan. So it has slightly waterfall shape at the front, and it has a sort of pleat at the back where your shaping goes. Okay. So, a fluffy one. What can I possibly use? Now, I'm not using the fluffy yarns that I showed you in December because I don't have enough of those. But many years ago, before I started the podcast, there was a place near to me that sold yarn on the cone very inexpensively. And I can be a bit of a sucker for a bargain. And also I can be a bit of a sucker for anything red. Again, size of my head yarn, that's the theme. Maybe I should rename this month's episode. That's showing up a little brighter on my camera. It's more towards a sort of burgundy. And I'm going to hold that with two strands of this. So I've pulled off half the cone. And I was sort of holding strands of yarn together. Do I want two of the red, one of the purple, two of the red, two of the purple? And I've decided I like the look best of two of the purple, one of the red. But what I might do, if I ever finish this thing, because it's still in the balance, is I might do collar, hem, cuff, pockets, two of the red together to give a kind of edging. So I'm going to get some large needles out. I'm going to cast on the fewer than 10 stitches that this starts with, and I'm just going to go for it. And like I say, you may never see it again. You may hear me say, what was I thinking? Well, you can remind me that it was today, and tomorrow is my father's funeral, so it's possible that I'm not quite in the straightest of minds. And then my camera battery ran out. Or, and I like to see the positive if I can, it could be that this turns into the favourite thing I have ever made, and I wear it all the time. We can but hope. So what is this yarn? Well, this is a red eyelash. The yarn, according to the cone, is called Genesis. They're a favourite band. Made in Spain. It says Miranda AS. It's got a load of letters and numbers. I think it's colour number 24. This is Sweetheart in the Damson colourway. But that is all I know, because these cones were bought for very little money. I'm assuming they're 100% acrylic. I haven't set fire to them or bleached them to find out, but I'm assuming that. And so it will be a warm, possibly too warm, jacket when it's made. This is very, very soft, this red. It is teddy bear-like. This is not bad. It's kind of mohair effect. Yeah, it's not bad. I've certainly felt a lot worse. And paid a lot more. So who knows what will happen, but we're going to start it and then see where we go, and that's fine. So yes, the funeral is tomorrow. Although conducting funerals is my job, I'm not conducting my dad's funeral. Two reasons mainly. Firstly, I don't think I could, and secondly, he had one of these prepaid insurance things where he paid for his funeral some years ago, and that includes an amount for the celebrant. Now, obviously, I'm not going to take a fee for my father's funeral. And when I've tried in the past to get them to make it direct to a charity, they won't do it. If it goes through my accounts, I then have to pay tax on it to then make a charity donation, which would upset my dad. And if I don't take a fee, the money is held by the company he paid for the... It's basically an insurance. And if he thought they were keeping that, he'd be very cross. So... we have a celebrant. As it happens, an old school chum of mine, Some years ago I did her father's funeral. In the last few years she's trained and become a celebrant. She said that I inspired her to do so. I suggested, she was thinking, well, if that idiot can do it, anyone can. So I contacted her and said, you know, would you be available? Would you be willing? I said, in one sense, it will be one of the easiest funerals you'll ever do, because I'm going to write the eulogy. Basically, I'm going to tell you what we want, deliver it as a kind of finished thing almost. You'll just have to top and tail it. On the other hand, it may be one of the hardest you'll ever do, because I'm quite a control freak. So she took on the mantle and is wearing it well. No, she's grand. She's doing a grand job, and she's been very understanding of seeing it from a celebrant's point of view as a mourner, if you see what I mean. So I will be speaking during the ceremony, but I've written a piece to say, and my middle sister's going to read a poem, and we're going to cry a lot, but that's okay. We're allowed to. That's tomorrow. Saturday is when this video will go up, so I will do a very quick roundup on Saturday, but for the moment that's it. I'm about to cast on a sweater that's going to make me look like a red and purple teddy bear. It's not a bad thing. Hello lovelies, it's Saturday, and yesterday morning I woke up feeling rough, sounding rough, not well, and went into a bit of a spiral, messaging my sisters, I'm not well, what am I going to do? My sister rang, she said, make sure you come up. I said, I don't know what to do for the best, I don't want to give it to anyone else. So she talked me down, bless her, she's good at that. And I still went to the funeral. I was masked up, obviously, and there will be those who will say I shouldn't have gone, and I completely understand that point of view, but this was the decision I made after a lot of thought. It felt like I was making the least worst decision rather than the best decision, and this is the decision I made. So for those who don't agree with me, you're allowed to not agree with me, but this is the decision I made. I was then thinking about how am I going to do my speech, because I still wanted to do that. And at the crematorium, most people are in the main room, but there is a sort of overflow balcony with extra chairs, so that if you get more than you can fit into the main room, some people can go upstairs onto that sort of balcony. And I thought, well, you see, if you'd asked my dad, he would have said he was expecting about a dozen people, and most of them would be family. We knew that more were coming than that, but had you asked him, this is what he would have said. So I thought, well, if need be, I would go up on the balcony and watch the ceremony from there, and I could do my speech from there. But then I thought it would be a little bit, don't cry for me, Argentina. So I'm glad that I decided against that. So, like I said, I was masked up. I made sure that when I spoke, I wasn't speaking from the lectern that the celebrant had to go back to, so that she wasn't then breathing my air, if you see what I mean. So I tried to be as responsible as possible. The real responsible thing would be not to go, but that wasn't an option for me. So the ceremony went well, and was done. And, you know, I mean, it's never fun. Well, actually, that's not true. Some of my funerals are hysterical. This one wasn't, but we did have some laughs along the way. And my sister read really well. She was reading a poem. So it all went as well as it could, I think, is the best way I can put it. All good. And my mate, my old schoolmate, played a blinder. She was brilliant. That all went. And I really don't feel well now. What it does mean is that I'm not able to go to Unravel tomorrow, which obviously I'm disappointed about. But I am being responsible about that one. It would not be kind to go to a place that's probably quite crowded. And even if I'm masked up,
it will be harder to kind of keep my space than it was yesterday. So I'm not going to Unravelry, which is very unravel, which is very disappointing. And it does mean I won't get to meet Benta tomorrow, which is also disappointing, but I'm hoping to meet her in the week when I've had a few days recovery. And hopefully I'll meet her in Lewis next week and we can sort of sit and have some lunch and that kind of thing. So that will be good. That will be good. So that's about it for this month, with one little extra. When I was unpicking that glove and talking about making a wrap, I was thinking about what yarn would go with the black elephant Merlin. Excuse me. And then I suddenly thought about what I had on the wheel at that moment. So this was a bat that I received as a gift from my lovely friend Evelyn, who I was also going to meet at Unravel tomorrow. Anyway, doing the sensible thing for once. So my lovely friend got me this bat for birthday, I think it was last year. And I had started to split it into three to do a classic three-ply. And then it occurred to me I could do a two-ply and make it a finer weight, because most of my three-plies are coming out kind of sport double knitting weight, whereas my two-ply yarns tend to come out more of a fingering four-ply sort of weight. Four-ply in the English, British sense of that's the weight of the yarn, not the number of plies. I know it gets confusing. But I thought that these colours would go well. So what I've done is I changed the amount of fibre I had. Instead of it being split into three, I split it into two. And then I have spun half of it, wound it into a cake, and then went from the two ends to ply those two together, and I have this. Which isn't mud, compared to other yarns I've spun in the past. Because it's a very colourful bat, I'll put a picture in here of it. And my fear was that I would turn it into mud, as I did with some fibre in the past. But we have definite colours in here. We can see teal, we can see yellow, we can see orange. Marvellous. And I think this will go well with that Merlin yarn. So I've done this half. I will spin the other half and I will use that as part of the project. But next weekend, I am away with friends, including the lovely Evelyn. So I will catch up with her next week, just not this week. And I wanted to take this project, because the other projects I've got on the go are sort of large sweater projects. Because this is going to be a shawl or a wrap. Basically, it'll just be this yarn plus the Merlin. No. Once you've got it plied and on the bobbin, there's still a bit of time in the process. I tend to leave it on the bobbin for 24 hours, then put it onto the niddy noddy, leave that for 24 hours, then soak it, then you have to wait for it to dry, then it needs I prefer to re-skein it, although I'll put it straight onto a cake as I'm going to use it. So because I want to use it next weekend, I wasn't going to wait until I'd spun the whole bat. I would work on this half and then work on the other half later. So that's what I've done. So that was February. Not the greatest month I've ever had, but life is light and shade, good and bad. And I am very grateful to friends and to all those who've been so supportive. Thank you to you who've been so supportive as well. It is very much appreciated. I'm going to spend the rest of this weekend asleep. No, I'm not, because it's the Zoom call this evening. Barbara of Flame and Fibre, Valerie of A Visit with Nana and Papa. It's the Zoom call that they sort of run between them. So I'll be on that this evening. But apart from that, I'll probably be asleep most of the weekend. And I'm back to work on Monday. So life goes back to the new normal. And we move onwards. So there we go. No Unravel. That's okay. Other things have taken priority and that's fine too. But whatever you're up to, I hope you have a good month. I will see you Friday for the weekly vlog, and the last weekend in March for the monthly podcast. But I hope that you're all keeping well. Look after yourselves. Take good care. Thank you so much for being here. And I'll see you again soon. Cheers. Bye-bye.